Hi everybody, my name is Megan Christian and I'm a researcher at the Institute for Microelectronics and Microsystems of the National Research Council in Italy. What we will try to do this evening is to repeat a key experiment that a French physicist, Poisson-Arago, did just about 200 years ago. His goal was to support the results of an essay by his colleague and friend, Augustin Fresnel, titled Mémoire sur la diffraction de la lumière, Mémoire on the diffraction of light, that explained diffraction phenomena treating light as a wave. Diffraction is a term that was first used by Father Francesco Maria Grimaldi in the 17th century and is still used today to describe phenomena in which light apparently does not want to follow a straight line, behaving more like a wave than a ray. Right here in Bologna, Father Grimaldi reported in his book De Lumine the first wave-like phenomena of light ever observed, and this about 150 years before the time of Arago and Fresnel. Before Fresnel's studies, many physicists thought that light was a corpuscular phenomenon and its propagation that of light molecules emitted from radiating bodies. Among these eminent scientists, Simeon-Denis Poisson publicly rejected the ideas of Fresnel's thesis, thinking that to demonstrate the absurdity of the wave theory, this simple but sharp argument was sufficient. If light propagated through waves as sound does, it would spread in all directions and just as we hear a bell ringing, even from a bell tower hidden from our eyes. We should observe light behind any opaque obstruction. From our daily experience, seeing light behind opaque objects hardly seems believable. In reality, we always observe shadows. But what happens to the object's shadow if we shrink the size of the light source to a very small spot? Are we really sure of the result? But let's return to Arago. He took Poisson's objection seriously, and being a clever physicist, immediately designed an experiment just to verify if light could be present inside the shadow of an opaque object, as strange as that may be. The amazing result of Arago's experiment settled the controversy, and I guess that it will also be quite surprising for most of you. We have chosen to repeat the experiment, keeping it as simple as possible. Very few ingredients will be necessary. First of all, quite obviously, a light source. In our case, we have chosen to use a helium neon laser. I'll say a few more words on this in a moment. Then an opaque object. To build our object, we have taken a small metal sphere. A microscope slide. And we have glued them together. Here is the result. Thirdly, a final screen where the result of our experiment will be observed. And fourthly, a lot of room, which is why we are here in the meeting room of our institute. And that's all. Let's start with our light source. Here we take advantage of the technology development since Arago's first experiment by using a laser. Let me switch it on first. Here is the window where the beam comes out. As you may see, we have here two mirrors whose inclination may be modified to move the laser beam. But where is it? Let's just put some smoke here to make the laser light visible. And here it is. This light is monochromatic, just one color, red. Now that's very different from the light source used by Arago. He worked in white light. White light is the light emitted from our sun, and more generally, that emitted by any thermal source, and consists of a sum of different colours. Avoiding the confusing superpositions of all these colours will give us the possibility to observe many more details than Arago did. Since Grimaldi, we know that any diffraction experiment requires the use of a very small light source. the laser is already a very good approximation to a point-like source. A property of the tiny laser source is that when propagating in free space, it keeps most of its power in a very small probe. So, let's take a look at what the laser beam looks like in close proximity to our object plane. On this paper sheet, you see a very bright spot at the center of a large, faintly illuminated circle. Let's start the experiment. First, with the laser off, I have to position our object on this holder. A critical step of this experiment is the alignment of the laser beam and our sphere. We'll use the strong central laser spot for this purpose, so I have to wear my glasses to protect my eyes. Here is the spot on the microscope slide. When I move it towards the object, you start to see the reflected beam. And now, the small spot is blocked by the object. Finally, after a bit of vertical adjustment, it is perfectly aligned. Let's switch off the lights and see what we have obtained on our final screen. Now, if I'm careful, I can take off my glasses. Undoubtedly, at the center of this dark shadow, we can see a bright spot. And that's the Arago spot. A bit ironically, in some optics textbooks, you may also find it called the Poisson spot. Indeed, Poisson's argument was correct. If a light is a wave phenomenon, it should behave as sound does, and you should observe light behind opaque obstructions. We also see that owing to wave interference, inside the shadow, this is its geometrical dimension, a number of beautiful concentric circular fringes contour the central spot. Now it is interesting to compare the mean light intensity in the region outside the shadow with that of the central spot. To this end, from this image of the central region of the pattern, we have calculated its rotational mean, and finally obtained the profile of the mean intensity across the center of the diffraction pattern. Quite surprisingly, at the pattern center, we get the same mean intensity of the outer regions. In other words, at this point in the center of the shadow, we get the same light that we would have if the object was not there. These are the words that Arago used to remember the difficult path that led to this discovery. If, for example, the shadows of opaque bodies had only been observed in the open air, if these bodies had never been illuminated with very narrow luminous points, no one would have guessed how much such a vulgar phenomenon offers curious research topics. But wait a moment, there's one more thing. Have you ever heard of photons? Photons mean light particles, and we need to assume their existence to explain phenomena like the photoelectric effect. No time to explain. This is really another story, but don't panic. We actually still use both wave and particle representations to explain light phenomena. Waves for describing mainly low energy phenomena, like diffraction, of which we have seen an example this evening, and particles mainly for those at high energy. The problem is that what we think a wave or a particle is has changed so much lately. But that's yet another story. We call it quantum theory.